And good morning, Grace Valley Church. How y'all doing today? Come on, stand on your feet for some worship. Put your hands together. Come on. The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty, so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. I'll sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Come on, let's sing it.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Come on, sing it.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Sing it with us.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. We sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. We sing, worthy, worthy.
Once again, good morning, Grace Valley Church. How y'all doing? You know, I'm going to ask Jake to come on the stage right now. Jake, how you doing? I'm good. You know what I realized today? There's chairs set up in this room. You know who didn't set up the chairs in this room? We did not do that. We have a chair team. Can we give our cheer team a big round of applause? They get here every Sunday at, what, like 6:45 or I don't know. But they set all these chairs up for y'all. So before y'all take a seat, go ahead and say hey to your neighbor, and then we'll be right back.
If you would go ahead and have a seat for a few minutes, we have an exciting day today. So today is baby dedication day. And so we have actually 9 kids being dedicated in this service and then 9 more in the next service. And that is just, it's amazing. Go ahead and clap. I mean, it's an exciting day in our church. Selfishly, it's job security for me as the youth pastor. So, 10 more years and I get 18 more kids. So today, baby dedication is this wonderful step for Christ-following parents seeking to create a Christ-centered home. And then here at Grace Valley Church, we want to encourage parents to consider the arrival of a child as this key milestone of faith and parenting, and it's a journey. And Proverbs 22:6 says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, even when he is old and will not depart from it." The mission of this family ministry here at Grace Valley Church is to equip parents to disciple, to be disciple makers at home and come alongside kids and students with strategic ministries so the next generation will know God, follow Jesus, and live on mission. And today is a key early step that these parents are taking. So like I said, today we have 8 families this morning, 9 kids that we are dedicating, and I want to introduce them to you. And so on this side, we have Mason Bryans and Hudson Bryans, and they are being dedicated by their parents, Austin and Melina Bryans. You can wave. Can you wave? There you go. And we have Scarlett Eloise Clark being dedicated by Patrick and Ann Clark. Callan, right? Did I say that right? Yeah. Callan Lucas Call being dedicated by Kevin and Katie Call. I'm too interesting back here. He doesn't want to look at the crowd. We have Lainey Haynes being dedicated by Graham and Lauren Haynes. We have Celia Joy Umber being dedicated by Andrew and Bethany Umber. Hey, buddy. We have Luca Cole Jordan. Luca, perfect. Being dedicated by Ben Jordan and Joanna Norman. We have Clark Mitchell McDaniel. Did I say it wrong? Michelle, I'm sorry. Clark Michelle McDaniel being dedicated by Cole and Caitlin McDaniel. And we have Evie Grace Seachlug. Being dedicated by Tyler and Natalie Seachlug. Beautiful, beautiful. And so it's recorded in Luke 2 that Jesus' earthly parents, Mary and Joseph, they presented him, Jesus, in the temple not long after he was born. And as church history has progressed, it's an opportunity to name or declare a preferred future of your child. Prayerfully one that has been that has a personal and saving relationship with Jesus at the center. And so we believe here at Grace Valley Church that it is important to make some commitments. And so to make the following commitments at this milestone of baby dedication. And that first commitment is a declaration of intent. This step declares the intent of you as the parent to set this child apart for the purposes of the Lord. And this means that you are making a commitment to raise this child according to the instruction of God's word and to guide them toward a life of faith in Christ and obedience to God and discovery of their God-given purpose. So parents, will you set this child apart for the purpose of the Lord? Number 2, an expression of hope. This step is an expression of hope in God's saving work and forgiveness in the life of this child at some point in their future. This ceremony does not produce salvation, but it works as a prayer for God to grant salvation for this child whenever he sees fit in this child's future. This ceremony marks a commitment for you to share the gospel, the good news of Jesus, in your home as part of your child's life journey. So will you, as parents, share the gospel in your home and earnestly pray for your child to receive salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ as your child grows up? And number three, it's an invitation to the body. Each parent making this commitment is also inviting God's church, the body of Christ, to come alongside and to serve as the supportive community to gain strength as parents and encourage the spiritual development of this child. So parents, will you invite this community of faith to encourage and support you in this great work of parenting? Now, church body, we each have our own role to play in walking alongside these families, their kids, as well as the other kids and students in this church. The discipleship journey is meant to be a multi-generational journey. So you have much to offer other generations, and they have much to offer to you too. So will you, as the church body, commit to walking alongside and investing in these families' faith journeys? We will. 3 John 1:4 says, I could have no greater joy than to hear that my children are following the truth. Let's pray. God, I thank you for these families. I thank you for their hearts, for their kids. And God, I pray blessings upon them. I pray that they raise these kids up in a home that is seeking you. God, I pray that there is discipleship happening inside the home, that the gospel is presented to these kids, God, and I pray your hedge of protection on these kids as they grow up. God, help them to have hearts after you. God, help them to not see the world as something that is being destroyed, God, but something that they can build up for your kingdom. In your name I pray, amen.
Will you stand with us, please?
See, on a hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me. My Jesus set me free. And look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side. No greater sacrifice. What he's done, what he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done.
Sing for the freedom he has won. Even death is dead and done. His life has overcome. Speak, say the name above all names, over every broken place.
He is risen from the grave.
What he's done, my future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done.
Now, on a throne of majesty, my Father's will complete. He reigns in victory.
Hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What he's done, what he's done, yeah. rapture is heaven. I praise God for what he's done. What he's done. What he's done. All the glory and the honor to the Son.
To the Son.
My sins are forgiven.
My future is heaven.
My future is heaven.
Paul's writing to the Romans, Romans 5, and he said, he basically says, who would die for a righteous man? Much less, who would die for a good man? But then he said, God demonstrated his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He died for us even though we may not choose him. He chose us. Christ died for a maybe. That's how much he loved us. But he not only died for us. Jesus spent 33 years on this planet living for us, glorifying and being obedient to the Father. Because without a spotless sacrifice, our redemption couldn't come true. So as we worship him this morning and we see his love demonstrated for us, let's worship him not only for how he died for us, but how he lived for us this morning. Come on. Come on, let's sing Behold.
Behold his holy Son, the Lion and the Lamb given to us. The Word became a man, and my soul should know his Savior. Forsaken for the sake of all mankind, salvation is in his blood. Jesus Messiah, the righteous died for love. But it wasn't my soul.
The Spirit breathing hope I find within my ever-present help, speaking truth when I can't find it.
Light up this broken heart and light my way till my time on earth is done. Oh, Holy Spirit, breathe in me thy kingdom come.
Come on, let this be your prayer.
Oh, Holy Spirit, let your work in me be done. And then sing to my soul. As the clouds he rides swing low, lift up the sound as he makes our praises his throne. Behold the Lord our God will lead us.
More than yesterday.
more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat, more than anything. Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side, 'cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you more.
With me. Father, there is none like you, and we worship you this morning, God. You're the Savior who died for just a maybe. And God, I pray that we know you this morning. In your name, amen. You may be seated.
But you remember the bumper last week? Bum, bum, bum. I won't try to do it this morning. Andy's not here, obviously. I'm here. Victor Lyons is my name. My Andy has gone on a special trip with his son. So pray for them, and they'll be back next week. After the service, though, we'd love to still meet you. If you're a first-time guest here, we'd love to greet you over at the front office. If you bring a little info card, we can get that so we can follow up with you. But we'd love to meet you. We have a special gift that you can have as well. So I want to invite you to that. Like I said, I'm Victor. I'm the group's pastor here. My thing is involvement. So if you've been coming to Grace Valley for a while and you're still looking for a way to connect or get involved with the church, and you're like, I'm not in a group yet, or I'd love to learn more about serve teams, I would love to talk to you about that. I would love to just meet with you and see what is it that you're called to, what is it that you're interested in. We have all kinds of groups and all kinds of ways you can get involved and invested, so I'd like to invite you to that. Today we're going to be continuing picking up right after Andy left off last week. Andy had one of the great passages of the Bible that you probably learned as a little kid, David and Goliath. So we learned how David is a champion for the nation of Israel, and how in a way Jesus does the same thing for us. He's our champion. He represents doing something that we couldn't do ourselves. And so today we're going to be looking at 1 Samuel chapter 18, and we're going to pick up right after that story picks up, talking about something that's pretty close to home. I looked at that and I was like, oh man, this is our problem today in a lot of ways. We're going to talk about Saul's jealousy. And looking here at 1 Samuel 18, starting in verse 6, it says, when the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joyful songs and with timbrels and lyres. As they danced, they sang, Saul has slain his thousands, and David his tens of thousands. Saul was very angry. This refrain displeased him greatly. They have credited David with tens of thousands, he thought, but me with only thousands. What more can he get but the kingdom? And from that time on, Saul kept a close eye on David. Saul, he hears the songs of these people coming in, and he starts to get these feelings. What are they singing? They're singing that Saul killed thousands. Now, that's a great song. He's probably like, oh, yeah, I killed my thousands. And then they're hearing this shepherd boy, this little pipsqueak, has killed 10,000s. And he starts to get that feeling. You know that feeling? He's getting jealous. He's like, wait a minute. I should be getting this glory. Why is David getting this glory? And he's keeping his eye on David. I think that's a great kind of a phrase to talk about jealousy, is that you get fixated on what you don't have. There's a syndrome that psychologists call the silver medal syndrome. Have you heard of this? The silver medal syndrome is what happens, especially in the Olympics. You'll see, when they take the platform after they do a competition, you'll have the bronze medalist and the silver and the gold. And what you would think is that the bronze medalist is probably like, well, I did fine. And then the second medalist is a little bit happier because, hey, it's higher than bronze, and gold is like ecstatic. But what you actually see is that the ones on gold are, of course, they're proud of their country, and they're happy, they're crying, they won. And the bronze is excited just because they're on the platform. They're like, hey, I almost didn't win. Their perspective is, I almost didn't make it, but I'm on the platform. Meanwhile, the silver medalist, they have their eye right above them because they almost got the gold. They came this close, and sometimes it really is razor thin, these competitions. And even though they literally according to their medal, are better than all the other ones. There's that one they didn't beat. And that's their focus. And so what you see is smirks. We actually, there's a real famous picture that came out of Michaela Moroni. And she was on the silver medal platform, not a smile. I mean, she tried to hold a smile a little bit. You can see the little video later. But in the end, they caught her smirk. Here she is. She is on a world stage for pole vaulting. And she beat everyone else. She's top in the world. And yet, what does she see? She didn't get gold. That one second place position ruins everything else. And the truth is, we in America, if you live here, y'all, we're in the top. We are all blessed beyond what we can imagine. And yet somehow we're also some of the less happy people. And it's because we keep looking at that one person that seems to have better than we do. And we're no better than Saul. We hear the voice, and yeah, God's given us all this stuff, and yet we get jealous. And a lot of it is because of something that's called reference points. And this is a field where they talk about, like, just like Michaela looks at that gold medal and she says, "Oh, I missed it by that much." Instead of looking down at all the things that she won and all the things she's accomplished, she's just looking at the top. That's what we do. We just fixate on one thing that we don't have, and that ruins it for everything else. It's one of the problems with social media. We look and we see, oh, they went on a vacation. I went on a vacation, but it wasn't as cool as theirs is. You went on vacation. But yeah, you think that, oh, well, I wish I'd done this or that. And, you know, meanwhile, there's people that haven't, and some of you maybe, you haven't been on vacation for a year now. And yet we compare. We play the comparison game. And we're like Saul. We're sitting there. Our champion is across the room from us, and we want to kill him because we wish we had what they have. Saul is so blind that the very person God sent to him to save him is the one he wants to kill. He's completely self-absorbed. He's hearing these voices. And it's because our reference points are wrong. A reference point is a standard or a way of thinking about things. You know, this past couple weeks, my son is in sixth grade. He's been doing the assessment tests, you know, all these state assessments. My wife is a sixth grade teacher, so she's giving these state assessment tests. All these tests, and more than ever, we're being tested in all kinds of ways to see if we measure up. The problem is, the Bible has a whole other set of reference points, a whole other set of standards. And the truth is, we are desperate for better reference points. When we only see the gold and we forget all the other things, that one thing we don't have, instead of seeing all that God has blessed us with, it changes our whole perspective. So this morning, what I pray we do is we have an attitude that looks 10,000 feet above. You know when you're in an airplane and everything seems small? You get a different perspective? That's what we need to do when we get jealous. When we start wishing for what we don't have, we need to take a look at how God sees things. We need to look above and look down and notice what God is doing. Because it can change our whole perspective of how God sees us, how God sees you, how God sees others, how God sees success. Changing our perspective changes the whole game. Instead of just fixing on the one thing. We see David do this. And so in verse 8, verse 10, it says here, 1 Samuel 18:10, the next day, an evil spirit from God came forcefully on Saul. That's what happens when you're jealous. You've opened yourself to the enemy. You let the enemy come in and start pitting you against others. The evil spirit from God came forcefully on Saul. He was prophesying in his house. Now, the idea is that Saul's basically ranting and raving. Even though he just won the battle, because David gets the credit, he's mad about it. Even though it was for his kingdom. And so he's ranting and raving. David's trying to calm him down with the lyre. David was enlisted to, even though David just won the giant, he's just going back to work. He's now relegated to being, okay, court musician. He's playing the lyre as he usually did. And it says, Saul had a spear in his hand and he hurled it, saying to himself, I'll pin David to the wall. That's how we feel when we get mad about something. I want to pin him to the wall. You feel out of control when you get envious of someone. You're like, I wish I could control that because it's not right. I should get that or I should have that. He wants to pin him to the wall. Now, this is the part that I noticed as I was doing chronological Bible reading this past couple weeks. And I saw this and I was like, wait a minute. Because do you see what it says at the end of that verse? But David eluded him twice. What does that say? Saul threw it at him twice. What does that mean? David was in the room. He hurls it once. I would be out of there. You know? Saul throws that spear, and I'm like, I guess he ducks, you know? I'm like, seeing him duck. Okay, dude. And he hangs in there. He throws it again, and he avoids it again. And he keeps doing his work. David has a different perspective. It helps him to see things that you wouldn't see. His perspective is from God's view. David has a purpose. He has a calling that helps him see not just what's in front of him, but it helps him see what's inside of him, what God has planted. We remember a few weeks ago, we talked about the anointing that David had. Now, that anointing is serious business, and in a way, David isn't seeing much fruit from that. Yeah, David won a battle, but he's still a court musician. He's still just the guy that happened to win. It seems like almost a fluke, and now Saul's after him. And it says that later Saul, in verse 12, I don't know if we have that on screen, but it says that Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David, but had departed from Saul. Verse 13, so he sent David away from him and gave him command over 1,000 men, and David led the troops in their command. I'm surprised by this. Here Saul is trying to kill David, and you know what David's doing? He's still being obedient. He's still serving Saul. How is he doing that? In everything he did, he had great success. And then down to 17, Saul said to David, here is my older daughter Merib. I will give her to you in marriage. Only serve me bravely and fight the battles of the Lord. For Saul said to himself, I will not raise a hand against him. Let the Philistines do it. So he's trying to do this thing where I'm going to send David into battle so that David gets killed. But David said to Saul, and this is a big thing, who am I? What is my family or my clan in Israel that I should become the king's son-in-law? David saw himself the way he is. He had a humility. And in a way, we can kind of scoff and say, oh, he's being modest. Well, we see later how David, his humility is one of the ways that he's a man after God's own heart. This is a hard work. This is a work of prayer. Lord, help me put things in perspective. Who am I really? And so he, in the end, Saul's like, okay. And so Saul doesn't do the marriage. So he gives the daughter to somebody else. And then Saul's daughter, Michal, it says in verse 20, was in love with David. And when they told Saul about it, he was pleased. I will give her to him so that she may be a snare. So now he's going to get her married so that she can trap him. And so that the hands of the Philistines may be against him. So Saul said to David, now you have a second opportunity to be my son-in-law. And then later in verse 31, they repeated these words to David, but David said, do you think it is a small matter to become the king's son-in-law? I'm only a poor man and little known. David has things in perspective. Who he is, he's just David, a person that makes choices like all of us. And here he's trying to put things in perspective. Sometimes we let the world define who we are. I heard a statistic how 42% of current college students have what they call fearful anxiety attachment. That means that different people are, you know, form relationships in different ways. If you're confident, then you form an attachment with people, friendships with people. confidently. You trust them, they trust you. A majority of college and up to 42% will admit that they're afraid of forming basic relationships. Right now, if you were to profile a typical college student, you would have a young man looking at his phone by himself in the hallway, waiting for a like or a follow, anxious and hurting. I had a college student recently. I was sitting in the congregation, and he called me up, and I was worshiping, and I was like, I can't answer the phone. Then he texts me. I need help right now. I'm not sure what to do, but he hinted that he was thinking about doing something to himself. And so I got up and I went out to the youth room and I called it up. I said, well, what's going on? This girl ghosted me. Ghosted you? Yeah, she ghosted me. I'm like, dude, I was ghosted constantly. I mean, growing up, that was kind of the way I grew up. You know, what is ghost? Some of you may not know. It's just basically you text a girl and then she doesn't text you back. I'm like, that's dating. I mean, that should be normal. But there's such an anxiety now. And you maybe have seen this where you're afraid because you want to measure your whole self based on what others think. You've put your entire identity, your entire purpose in other people. And look, I want you to know that God loves you. He created you. You are important. Mr. Rogers had it right. He would come out at the end of every episode. You are special. You are special. And I know that I'm not talking participation trophy stuff. I do not. That's a whole other thing. That's your special, but not really. Everybody gets a trophy. No, you're special, not because you participated in this activity or did this certain thing. God created you. So you're special. These babies, they haven't done a thing yet except, you know, cry and poop and keep their parents up. But they are so precious. They don't have to do a thing. God created them. They're already wonderfully made. We're God's workmanship. God's going to do a wonderful thing in their lives. Life is precious. We don't have to tolerate people. We love them. But the thing is, first, you got to know yourself that you are loved. There was a moment in my life when I was absolutely knocked off my feet. I've shared it before a little bit, but I remember there was my last Sunday preaching after things fell apart in my family, and I felt like here I was, pastor, dad, preacher, evangelist, I had a church planner, and in one Sunday, I was like, I can't keep doing it. I lost it all. And I'll never forget, I still mustered, I don't even know how. I guess the Holy Spirit gave me enough sense to go to church the next week. I walked into a church, and it was my buddy, and he was surprised to see me because he knew that I was at another church. He's like, what are you doing here, Victor? And then he said, oh, I remember. Come on in. I said, look, Eric, I can't keep going. I feel like my arm's chopped off. He said, I understand. I did what everybody does when you feel that way. You sit in the very back of the church. You're like scoping out the exit. How quickly can I go in and out? I'm in the end of back row guy in a way. And I remember the text. I don't remember much of what was preached. But I remember that he read from Philippians chapter 3. Where Paul says that I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. If anybody has confidence, it would be me, Hebrew of Hebrews, Pharisee of Pharisees. I have all these things going for me, but in the end, I count all of that as garbage. All those identifying marks, all those things that people look at me and think that's what makes me special. That is not what makes me special. Those are worthless. Those are all crucified. I am crucified. That's what he's saying. I'm crucified with Christ. What matters is what Christ has done for me. All that other stuff doesn't matter. I'm in Christ. I'm his son. And I remember walking out of that church, and I'm like, you know what? I don't have anything else, but I'm at least still his son, his child. That's what matters. And in the end, no matter what your title is, no matter what's in your bank account, no matter what people might like or what you've done, in the end, you can't drive a limo into the what is that old saying? Can't take a limousine into the grave or whatever. There's an old saying. None of that matters. In the end, what matters is how God sees you. And David, he has confidence because he knows who God has called him to be. He's going to keep on doing his work. He's going to keep on serving Saul until Saul runs him out of town, because he's got a purpose. He's got an identity that's beyond what other people might want to say, beyond that spear that's on the other end. Our reference point should be how God sees us, not how our social media sees us or how other people see us. It's God's point of view. But beyond that, we should see other people for how God sees them. This is even harder sometimes. We kind of see other people and we like to do the comparison game ourselves. But what God calls us to is to see other people the way that God sees them. And we see an example of this a little later in the story in 1 Samuel chapter 24, if you'll turn with me there. 24 verse 3, I dared myself whether I was going to preach this part, but I'm going to try because it starts with a kind of, anyway. Saul does end up running David out of town. And they start chasing each other. You know this story. Saul approaches David, then David almost kills Saul. This happens a few times, but this is the one that I was going to focus on. Verse 3, he came to the sheep pens along the way. A cave was there. So Saul is chasing after David, and Saul went to relieve himself. So Saul goes in the cave, and when you got to go, you got to go. And so Saul goes, and he's using the bathroom in the cave. And as he's doing this, yeah, it's in the Bible. He relieved himself. And I wish Jake was here. He'd do better at making that a joke. I can't make it a joke. Saul's in the bathroom, and David comes in, because David happens to already be in the cave. He's further down in the cave. And it's like, wait a minute, this is an opportunity. While he's doing this, the men said, this is the day the Lord spoke of when he said to you, I will give your enemy into your hands for you to deal with as you wish. It says, then David crept up unnoticed and caught off a corner of Saul's robe. So David creeps up to Saul. He could have killed him, but he takes off the cloth, the corner of Saul's robe. It says afterward, this is odd. This next verse is odd. Afterwards, David was conscience stricken for having cut off a corner of his robe. He said to his men, the Lord forbid that I should do such a thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, or lay my hand on him, for he is the anointed of the Lord. And with these words, David sharply rebuked his men and did not allow them to attack Saul. And Saul left the cave and went on his way. What? Here is someone who has tried. I mean, I would claim self-defense in a way. You know, that other story where Saul threw the spear at him, David could have just picked up the spear and threw it back. But it's like every opportunity David has to kill Saul, he doesn't. And we see here why. Because David sees Saul the way God sees him, not the way he sees him. He's like, this is the Lord's anointed. Why am I going to kill him? This is someone that David is looking at him from God's perspective. Folks, when we are dealing with other people, God calls us to see them not the way we might want to, but the way God sees them. This changes everything. We seeing people as people who need the Lord. This is hard. I one time remember I was going through a small town and my tires went out. One of my tires was busted and I didn't know what to do. And I found the one place I could get a tire change, Walmart Tire Care Center. Any of you been to the Walmart Tire Care Center? That is a lovely place. They get pretty cheap, you know, tire change. But I went to the Walmart Tire Care Center, and at this particular place, it was like Grand Central Station for people. Because what they had was a little TV that was playing Judge Judy. And that, I thought, what in the world is going on? Nope, Judge Judy's on. So there's all these people. I don't think they were all waiting for a tire change. Some of them were just there for Judge Judy. So they're all sitting around watching Judge Judy. And I'm sitting there, and I'm reading through a C.S. Lewis book, and I'm trying to figure out things that I'm probably going to be teaching soon. And I'm sitting there, and I'm like, the people watching was amazing. But I was getting distracted, and I was kind of frustrated. I don't know if you've ever been to somewhere where you just get frustrated. It's like the DMV. I was like, come on, when is the tire ever going to be done? I'm running late. They're all watching this thing, and they're all talking back to Judge Judy like she can hear them. If you've ever, you tell them, Judge, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I'm sitting there, I'm reading a sermon by C.S. Lewis called The Weight of Glory. My mind is in a whole different place. And I'm reading through to the end of The Weight of Glory. And it says this, it says, there are no ordinary people. You have never talked to a mere mortal. Nations, cultures, civilizations, these are mortal. And their life is to us as the life of a gnat. But it is immortals whom we joke with, marry, snub, and exploit. Immortal horrors or everlasting splendors. This doesn't mean we are perpetually solemn, we must play, but our merriment must be of that kind which exists between people who have from the outset taken each other seriously. No flippancy, no superiority, no presumption. So what is all that saying? These people are important. They're immortal souls. They're created by God. They matter. And I'm looking and I'm like, really? These people, they've got destinations. They've got potential. They have purpose. They're either going up or down. They're either going to heaven or going to hell. And I have a responsibility to them. They matter. These people that you're waiting in line with, they're not just waiting in line. They're people that God created and God loves. Just like we were saying about how we should see ourselves, we should see others as people that matter to God. I rushed out. I wish I could say then I started to tell everybody about Jesus. But it's always stuck with me, because what I did is I looked up from the book and I started seeing everybody a little differently, a little bit differently than I did before. Those people watching Judge Judy, they need the Lord. That person that you're jealous of, I guarantee you they're going through a valley deeper than you would want to cross. You just may not see it. Sometimes the people that post the most, they have the most to cover up. And you've been competing and you've been biting people that may need you to share something of the gospel, something of your valley. We need to see people the way God sees them, as people that are created in the image of God, that need a Savior just like we do. Paul says this, he says, we've no longer considered others from a human point of view. That changes the whole game. That's how Paul did what he did. He saw what God did in his life, and then he said, you know what? I'm not going to see you as a Jew or a Greek or a Gentile. He even says this, and I know this is going to sound strange, but he says, I don't even consider people male or female or Jew or Greek anymore. All that matters is, do they know Jesus? We live in a world where we want to label each other. I mean, that's the name of the game, is labeling and label myself. What is my identity? What is all this stuff? God gives us a new identity. In Christ is the identity. And what we want is we want others to join that family of God. Be part of this, because they matter. Others matter. And then finally, we need to see each other, not just how God sees you or God sees others, but how God sees success. Sometimes when I play that comparison game, I'm like, well, they seem to have done a good job and I may not be doing great. You know, that whole like feeling of failure you get sometimes. Well, what's interesting is even though David's running from Saul, he's looking at it from God's perspective, and it changes things because he's not even measuring success the way we might measure it. Look at Psalm 57. We're going to look at a psalm because the reference point that David uses leads him to sing. And the book of Psalms, are actually a lot of them are written during the events that we're reading about in Samuel. So in Psalm 57, you see at the very top, it says, for the director of music, to the tune of Do Not Destroy. It says of David, when he had fled from Saul into the cave. So this is exactly the moment that we've been talking about, when David ran into the cave from Saul. And it says this, he sings this. He says, have mercy on me, my God, have mercy on me, for in you I take refuge. I will take refuge in the shadow of your wings until the disaster has passed. He says, I cry out to God Most High, to God who vindicates me. He sends me from heaven and saves me, rebuking those who hotly pursue me. God sends forth his love and his faithfulness. He says, I am in the midst of lions. I am forced to dwell among ravenous beasts, men whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are sharp swords. But be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. They spread a net for me. I was bowed down in my distress. They dug a pit in my path, but they have fallen into it themselves. And this whole time, what David's doing is, his success isn't what he's accomplishing. He sees success as what God's accomplishing. We need to see success not as what we are doing, but what God's doing for us. And praising God for what God's doing. He has a whole different view. Success isn't in how much you've accomplished, what's your bank account, how big your boat is. It's how is God using my life and rescuing me? And he's already rescued you. That's what happened when Jesus died on the cross. There's a whole other measure of what a life of success is that the Bible teaches us. Here at Grace Valley, we have a list of four things for you to measure how God's using you and how God's working in your life. We talk about rescue, how God rescued. That's what we see with David. He says, God has rescued me, so I'm going to exalt him because he's the one that has caused success. And then he says in verse 7, my heart, O God, is steadfast. My heart is steadfast. Not only has God rescued him, but God has given him a peace. We call that having freedom in Christ, rescue and then freedom, because even though we know that we've been rescued, God is continuing to do a work, that old-fashioned word is sanctify us, helping our heart, strengthening our heart. Maybe you've experienced salvation, maybe you've been baptized, but you still don't have peace. You still are struggling with sin or struggling with relationship with others. That's a measure of how God's working in your life is, how much are you free from those things that shackle you? But not only does he give freedom, it says in verse 7 also, I will sing and make music. David has a purpose. And yeah, it's not the purpose of being a king yet. That's coming. Right now he's a musician. And for David, that's a pretty good purpose. Some of you may have found rescue or freedom, but you're still looking for a purpose. And that's something we want to walk alongside you with, is where God wants for you, what God wants for you. It's much more than the world wants for you. He has great plans. He says, awake my soul, awake harp and lyre, I will awaken the dawn. I mean, it's like David's like, come on, rooster. He's like competing against a rooster. I'm going to play my heart out till the dawn comes, all night long. And then verse 9, I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. For great is your love, reaching to the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be above the earth. What he's saying here is he's got joy in the Lord. Even though he's still running from Saul, even though things aren't exactly, the circumstances aren't lined up the way he wants, he still has joy. And some of you haven't felt joy in a while. You might smile. You may pass me in the hall and say, I'm fine, doing fine. But you're still looking for joy. And this morning, I want to say that's okay. We are all still growing in rescue and freedom and purpose and joy. But what God wants for you is not to look at the reference points around us and try to measure up to other people or what other people are thinking or other people are saying. He wants to say, have you received the salvation that comes from me? It's for us that God is working, not against us. Have you accepted Christ as your Savior? Jesus has paid it all for you. So this is like Jacob was saying earlier, that even though we were enemies of God, it says in Romans, Christ died, not for the godly, for the best. Christ died for the ungodly. And maybe this morning you're saying, well, I became a Christian years ago, but I've been drifting. And I'm in addiction right now. I'm trying to self-medicate from all the things that have been weighing me down. I look and I see how far I've gone. There's no way I can get free of this. God wants you to find freedom. He's working freedom in your life. And some of that is by joining group with others. Or maybe God has put on your heart that what you need is purpose. And you need a purpose in your life. Wherever it is, I want to invite you to do something this morning. And I'm going to just say it almost like a poll. Don't worry too much about it. Get out your pen. Get out your info card. I want to encourage everybody to do this. So go ahead and do it. I'm watching you. Go ahead and do it. We're going to do this like my son had a test, all the testing going on. I want you to do a self-assessment. Get the info card out. I want you to put your name on there. It doesn't have to be your last name. Forget all the other reference points in your life. Forget what the social media says. Forget what I'm going to say, what other people, who cares about what other people say? I want to know what God thinks. Think about how God's seeing you right now. Take the roof off of this building and think of how God is looking at you right now. Which is the thing that you need right now more than anything else? Do you need rescue or freedom? Are you looking for purpose? Maybe all you need right now is some joy. I would love for you to put your name there and just put one of those words, one word. You can even put the letter R or F or P. I'd love to pray for that. And you can put it in the black boxes at the end. That can be a response. Or, you know, we're about to sing together. And as we're singing, don't worry about what other people are thinking. Come down, pray with me, pray with Jake. Because God wants you to move and grow. Yes, we are called to grow in the Lord, but we have to do it together, and it starts with confession. It starts by saying, Lord, in response to what you're doing in my life, this is what my heart cry is. This is what I'm hoping for. This is what I need. Help me. Maybe some of you, you've been holding on a spear like Saul, and you've been jealous. It's hard to admit that. It's time to let that go. See other people the way God sees them. Start seeing yourself the way God sees you. Just like those little pretty babies. We're all just little babies that need Jesus. So ever God's calling you, I encourage you, maybe it's going to be hard, put your name, put what you need, what God needs you, and let's respond. Let's all stand and sing together. God, you're so good. The hardest words in this song is believing the bridge. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. So as you sing that, we pray that you believe it because of what the Bible teaches us. Let's sing together. Won't you come?
Amazing love that welcomes me, a kindness of mercy that bought with blood wholeheartedly my soul undeserving.
Sing with me.
God, you
You're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Behold the cross, age to age, and hour by hour. The dead are raised, this sinner saved, the work of your power.
God, you're so sing it. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. I am blessed. I am healed, I am whole, I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with your power for the glory of Jesus' name. I am blessed, I am called, I am healed.
Suffering, Lord, I will remember.
Remember this.
What Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever.
God, you're so
lift your voice and sing it with us.
God,
you're so good. Amen. You can have a seat.